What an incredibly interesting challenge you have ahead of you. And if one wants any reminder of how pressing and how ongoing this challenge of housing is, I took a lift to get here from miles away in Santa Monica. I was chatting with my driver. He turns out to live in Inglewood. I say, what do you think of the football stadium? He says, oh my God, my rent. And his rent has gone up along with the seven other people who have a unit in his 10-unit building. His rent has gone up $250 in the last few weeks since the building was purchased. He told me about so many of the people in that building who don't earn enough to pay that, just that extra, it seems like a small amount, $250 a month. But some of them are looking, he says, at moving back in with families. They're worried, and they're looking at more price increases. If you just take that one instance and you multiply it, this is endemic to Los Angeles right now. And so as we were told, as we learned earlier from the previous panel, you know, many, many, many Angelenos are just one rent check away from the streets. And it's not a case of them and us, it's a case of all of us in finding a way to sort through this problem. Just a little plug for DNA, the show. I should just say that next Tuesday's program will feature an interview about Minneapolis and the 2040 plan, and specifically their seemingly radical move to upzone the single family zoned neighborhoods. I definitely urge you all to look at that, because that seems like quite a radical solution that may bring forth new activity from the private sector as well as the public sector. And you learned in the previous panel, make sure to think about advocacy creatively, advocating creatively around zoning is definitely something that we've all got to, I think, be thinking about. And it's bizarre, because when I moved to LA 25 years ago, zoning was like, people zoned out if you brought up the topic of zoning. It was not considered an interesting topic, and now it's sort of driving so many conversations around housing and about where LA goes in the future. Anyway, so with those little preambles, let us turn to our panel. The point of this panel is really in a way to flesh out what you heard in the previous panel. It was a fantastic discussion in which, you know, you were taught about the complexity of the challenge that faces you, threading the needle of politics, policy, neighborhood reactions to housing coming into their areas, and then, of course, the design piece. You heard many recommendations for how to think about your design projects from the seemingly banal, but actually the incredibly important, like how many bathrooms per number of people in the units and so on, the presence of pets, whether or not that's, you trade off the bathrooms with shared public space. Anyway, all manner of very interesting provocations that you just heard. What we're now going to do is hear from, first of all, from three people who are in the trenches, working through these many, many thorny, I guess, Gordian knots of problems pertaining to getting housing for the formerly homeless built. We're then going to hear a presentation direct from Mexico City, where in Mexico they did a really remarkable project around housing. You're going to hear about that. And then we're going to open it to the floor for questions. So your voices will be heard if you would like them to be. Let us start with our guests. First of all, to my immediate left, I think you heard over and over again references to Flyaway Homes. Well, Flyaway Homes has flown in their COO, and he is Kevin Hirai. We should say that, just in case you were wondering what is Flyaway Homes, it is a for-profit permanent supportive housing developer. The for-profit piece being interesting, and it does raise some questions, I think, factoring into how one makes affordable housing affordable. He also chairs the Permanent Supportive Housing Committee of the People Concern. That is one of LA County's largest social service agencies. It was formed out of the merger of two quite well-known social service agencies, OPCC, which was very active on the West Side, and LAMP Community. This task force that developed the framework for what would become Flyaway Homes' social impact equity solution, which will tell us about, to the homeless crisis. He's a graduate of USC, he's a graduate of Harvard University's Graduate School of Design. Welcome, Kevin. I think to be in LA, and especially to do anything that touches on the civic realm, is to know Deborah Weintraub. She's an incredible gift to this city. I've known her many, many years, talked to her many times, and wherever there's something going on interesting at the intersection of infrastructure, civic space, and design, you find Deborah there. She's the chief deputy city engineer for the Bureau of Engineering, the highest ranking architect in the city. She oversees the architecture and engineering organization of approximately 1,000 people. She stays very calm while doing it, has approximately 480 active projects totaling $3.6 billion. They include homeless facilities, LA River projects, cultural facilities, transportation facilities, recreational buildings, parks, general office facilities, and bridges. And specific to this afternoon, her department is serving as the design and construction manager for the Bridge Home temporary facilities that we heard referenced several times, and she will tell us more about that, and for the Prop HHH-funded city projects also referenced. And these are permanent facilities. She's helming teams that involve city architectural and engineering staff, on-call architectural consultants, and contracted homeless service providers. And that's just another piece of the Gordian's knot of getting housing for the formerly homeless up, is the sheer numbers of groups that get involved. I mean, you have to be a politician just to handle all the multiple stakeholders and teams that are involved. Lorcan O'Herlihy, I'm sure all of you in this room have followed Lorcan O'Herlihy's work, and if you haven't, you should. One of LA's very gifted designers, many of the others are in this room. He's the founder and principal of his own firm, LOHA, or Lorcan O'Herlihy Architects, focuses on housing and urbanism. They are currently working on 4 affordable housing projects throughout LA. MLK 1101, is that on MLK Boulevard? Isla de Los Angeles projects in South LA, the Sun King project in Sunland, and those are aimed at previously homeless individuals and veterans. Their Westlake project near MacArthur Park is going to provide 78 housing units for local artists and other low-income families with lots of open park space, arts education program. And it is another example of how the firm is exploring ways to try and make affordable housing, again, more affordable through the use, he'll tell us more about this, of fabricated and modular components. So with that, I'm now going to, let's start actually with you, Kevin. Flyaway Homes was referenced a number of times, and also, again and again, we heard that sort of good design can be a tool, or rather, not can be, should be, is a very important tool in smoothing the path to getting housing for the homeless, formerly homeless, built. But Flyaway Homes has also tried to do it efficiently and economically, and that has implications for the design. Tell us what you're doing.
Yeah, I think, thanks, Frances. I think that it's important to understand sort of where we come from, and that is the client-centric approach coming from the Permanent Supportive Housing Committee, and that's really where this model, the for-profit modular construction delivery model, production model of supportive housing sort of was developed over several years, similar to this Charrette. It was a diverse group of, a think tank of a diverse group of individuals, bankers, public health experts. I'm a property manager. We all came to the table to understand sort of what the issues are and come together with a holistic approach. And so I think that it's very important, and I know that it may sound cliche, but it is important to design for the client. And in our case, the customer, whether it's, as Jerry had mentioned, a student, or in this case, a person who was formerly homeless, you have to think about their needs and where they're coming from and what's important to them. And that's sort of how Flyaway came up with what we're now experimenting with, which is this production model of supportive housing.
Designed for the client without actually meeting the client, because you're not sitting down with a group of your potential residents and saying, what do you want?
No, I think that that's an important part of the process, and that absolutely is part of our process, is understanding, you know, we operate shared scattered site housing right now. The agency does, I'm sorry. And they understand, you know, what those particular issues are. And so going back to the design, I think that you just really have to think about whether it's a bathroom that's important to that person, or whether it's, you know, just having a roof over their head so that they can think about becoming a productive member of society. I think that that's the important part.
But give us an example of a Flyaway Homes project and tell us, what is the building method that you're using? And
sure. So I'm trying to find one of our renderings, but we have a project that was complete on Colden Avenue. And there we did 9 units
that were in South LA.
In South LA. And what we've used is a modular construction using shipping containers. And so 5 8x20 foot shipping containers are put together to make a 1 4-bedroom, 1 bath modular unit. And by doing so, we're basically creating, we're site building a foundation, and the building becomes a product. And so I think that that's sort of key to our production model and being able to scale building on smaller sites.
How much is it costing? Because we keep hearing the number 400,000 or even 500,000 per unit.
So we like to do a per person standard, and so our 33 person development costs $3.6 million.
I'm sure there'll be people in this room who are thinking about possibly treating housing as a product, making something that could be mass produced, perhaps looking to modular or prefab. Was that a complicated approvals process? What did that involve?
Well, I think Deborah can maybe give some insight on that. But essentially, because everything above the foundation becomes a state-approved product, all we're permitting at the site level is the foundation and site utilities. And so it makes it a much more streamlined process. And at the same time that the foundation is being built on site, the modules are being built in the factory. And that's about a 3-month process. And at the end of that, then the two are married.
Mm-hmm.
And so the total development cycle is about 8 months.
One of the comments that was made this morning was, earlier, was respect the client, respect the person who's going to be dwelling. And I think Christopher said, you know, don't do a flourish that really might not be that improve the quality of life of that individual, where it might look great on the rendering,
right,
but it's not actually what the resident really cares about. Prefab containers, you know, I'm sure there's many of us in the architecture community that think prefabs are great and think shipping containers are great. We'd happily live in a thing that looks like a metal tin can. But actually, do you have to think about the aesthetics? Do you alter the surface of the metal tin can so that perhaps, is that an issue? Do you feel that even the sort of industrial look of a stack of containers is something you have to give consideration to?
I mean, we happen to use containers as our modules. It's the base frame of our modules for the first two projects. I wouldn't say that it's the only way to do it, and I would say that maybe there are more efficient ways to do it using wood, or maybe a steel moment frame with wood frame inside of that, a purpose-built steel moment frame. So the shipping container, yes, there are certain aesthetics. I think that it's sort of trendy and cool to design with shipping containers these days, or that sort of corrugated steel look. But as far as the reason why we use shipping containers as the base module is because of the structural integrity, and that it's a repeatable process, and there are a lot of them. And so that's what sort of drove us to that.
But you have to cut into the steel, don't you, to make
right.
the windows. It becomes a little bit more complicated, doesn't it?
You lose a lot of efficiency there. That's why I mentioned the purpose-built steel moment frame may be the better solution. And this is being done in Japan. It's being done in Scandinavia. Just the technology in the factory, the capital expenditure needed to make a factory like that is very, very great. And it's just prohibitively expensive.
And how's it been met with in the project, say, in South LA? How do the locals respond?
Well, we had a neighborhood council meeting, and we explained exactly what the project was, and I think it was surprisingly, we were a little bit nervous, but it was surprisingly met with support. There were a couple of people in the audience that had legitimate concerns that needed to be addressed, I think, and there are a lot of the same concerns that maybe a lot of people in the audience had, but that just didn't say it. Security, you know what I mean? This idea, a lot of what the concerns are misconceptions. So when people like Tommy Newman talk about, you know, everyone in and this whole anti-NIMBY is really the solution, to getting this built, because once people understand, it's not going to attract, you know, these are people, first of all, that live in tents in your neighborhood. They're either going to live in tents in your neighborhood, or we're going to build housing for them. And so I think that it's along those lines of balancing the aesthetics with the functionality. I think that, you know, it's a balance. And so we did think about aesthetics. We want it to look nice. You know, we want it to be a place that you feel comfortable living. But we also did think about the design and the functionality. And I think it was mentioned, you can design the interior of a particular...
There it is.
So because we have a four-bedroom configuration, and because we recognize that the bedrooms are a little bit smaller, we provided outdoor space. And it was brought up that there's a ratio. So this is important, I know, because you don't have these architecture students might not have the same framework of the homelessness crisis and sort of what is required to support these supportive housing communities. And so support services are a very important part of it. And it was mentioned there's a ratio, 1:25, 1:20. And in our projects, we do design for private office space for case management. We also designed an outdoor space directly adjacent to the community slash case management space, because you have to realize what a therapy session might look like isn't, okay, you're gonna come and meet me at 9:30, we're gonna sit down and have a therapy session. It could be as simple as just, let's sit down right outside here and talk a little bit. That's a therapy session. So we've designed these sort of breakout areas, and that's when I say, think about the client, and in our case, coming from the agency side, the support services that need to be provided on site. We have 2.5 full-time case managers at each of our 33-bed developments. So they need parking. They need to be able to have, like I said, lockable, private, soundproof space where they can talk about finances. You've also got to provide, ample outdoor space. If people are going to be living in a shared space environment, they need to be able to get out of that and enjoy the outdoors. And so this is when I mentioned it is cliche to say client-centric, but that's really what makes these projects work. And the Flyaway Homes approach, it's we learn by doing, and it's not an ideal, but I think that we can tweak and move towards that more ideal. So I don't want to take too much time, but I think going back to the design, our first project was a 4-bedroom, 1-bath design. If you want to talk about zoning, it's because it was zoned RD 1.5. The PSH ordinance was not in place, and we figured, let's not make the perfect be the enemy of the good. Let's build 9 units as opposed to waiting for that ordinance to pass, which eventually got challenged, right? And so thank goodness we did. We built it. Our second project, same thing. We're using different guidelines to build, and we can build 17 units within the same footprint, essentially. And they're 2-bedroom units instead of 4-bedroom units. So the ratio of bathrooms goes from 1:4 to 1:2. And eventually, if we can build efficiencies into the model, we would love to do 2-bedroom, 2-bath shared housing. I think that would be an ideal combination of making it pencil and making it function right for the client.
And we're going to jump to Lorcan, but lastly, your company's called Flyaway Homes, but these homes aren't going to fly away. They're permanent.
They're definitely permanent. Yeah. And so by permanent, what that means is there is no defined lease period. The intention is to provide a home for the individual to be housed, think about the other afflictions they're facing or whatever other challenges they may be facing. And that really, when you talk about what is a solution to homelessness, it's homes, right? And it may sound simple, but if you really think about it, that is really what we need to think about doing, is how to deliver this type of product quickly, efficiently, and to scale.
Great. Lorcan, over to you. You've been thinking about a lot of these, and you too are now starting to work with some modulo as well. Mm. But take at least one of your projects and tell us how you try to solve some of the challenges that were thrown at the students earlier.
I certainly will, my old students. I always see this as being to be an architect and take all this information. You have to be ruthlessly optimistic to be able to pull it off. Our approach and strategy with regards to our work is looking at all socioeconomic strata and produce work for homeless all the way up to housing for homeless all the way up to market rate. We think that's critical And it's very important when you design these projects in areas that it plays an incredibly important role in terms of getting the work through, meaning NIMBYism doesn't play that critical role. If your building that you're designing for supportive housing or homeless housing is better than the buildings on the other street, it's an asset to the client. It means that they can push it, they can get their, they have the resources to be able to do it, and that's a critical thing that we bring to the table. We think as an architect, you have to build very smart and intelligent ways, so you have build efficiency into it, but you bring that vibrancy and that idea. So all the work is underpinned by ideas. So the project on Martin Luther King, which
was
is
was that
on,
the one we just saw, the white one?
No,
no,
it'll spin around, it'll come back. It's the white building. It's carved away, it opens to the street. We think these buildings are critical to be able to have a relationship with the sidewalk and street, so they're not turning its back. You see that this is kind of welcoming type project. We did design the project's 26 units. There's a mix between studios, one bedrooms, and three bedrooms. The reason there are three bedrooms are there are families on the street. So that was essential. That was a little bit different than perhaps how it was done in the past. And so with that mix, we had to also look at the challenges of families living in the building. And if they're living next to individuals, how does that work? So from our perspective, from an architectural perspective, is we're trying to solve problems from a creative way. We ended up also brought sustainability. It's a LEED Gold project, meaning that these buildings need to have that aspects of design. So it's not simply looking at materiality, not simply looking at other aspects of design, but bigger ideas. And that's what we are trying to accomplish with this project. All the buildings are exterior access, which means you have cross ventilation, which means you use less AC, meaning they don't have to turn on the fan or use it. But you can open one window on one side of the unit and open a window on the other, and then you have cross ventilation. So these are big ideas that I believe are, I'm convinced, is critical design issues. We do think formally is essential. Aesthetics are critical. You have to bring design into these projects. They are create an uplifting component to it. The materiality is a hybrid between metal, cement board, and some options, some aspects of the exterior skin is also plaster. But the bigger idea is that we also have program design criteria. We have community rooms, community kitchens, and we also provided, and we'll get there, retail on the street. The purpose of the retail was to find programs that create revenue generating, it could be revenue generating, to provide funding for the operations of the building. So that's a very important component as well. The budget to do it was $16.7 million, but after they move in, which they've all now moved in, how do you operate? So these are interesting design issues, and they lead to very good design solutions. This is one of our projects near the 110 and 105, and it's a container building. So each project is somewhat different, somewhat unique to each project. I think that was also an issue that was brought up. How do we make these unique? And that's extremely important, so you're not doing identical projects. This is the one on Martin Luther King, so that's the community kitchen. This is outdoor space, and then the building is on the left in this view. This particular project was interesting also is that we focus, there it is right there in the context of the city. All the units are primarily driven by bedrooms and bathrooms. That was brought up in the earlier discussion, which is extremely important. They like that sense of privacy with a bedroom, and they want that issue of being able to have available a bathroom. What we did compress was the kitchen and living room. So those spaces are less, so you're focusing and recognizing the type, who you're building for. Now that wouldn't apply to other type of clients, but when you're dealing with the people who are gonna live here, they're more focused on having that private bedroom and so they can close it, so they have that moment, and equally so the bathroom. So that was really interesting to design the project because you had to look at all those program issues. I believe that brought a much stronger solution. The building also is carved away, meaning we want it open to the street. That's why we have this step that goes right down to the street. We want people who are walking on the sidewalk to recognize that this is something that's extremely important and that building should have that public-private dynamic between the city and the building. So most of our work, whether it's container building or from out of this project, Martin Luther King, which was a conventional construction, and I agree what you mentioned about containers. I think it pencils out around $500 per unit, and equally so, our building penciled out at $500,000 per unit. Our buildings were also $500,000. So that number is so challenging because you think in the early stage it's less, but in the end when you pencil it out, it's more.
Now, but Kevin says that then it wound up being less per head,
yes.
They count per head.
Yeah, so some, if the bedroom has three beds, that means you have three people in there, so that's where it works out. So more beds works better. So it's just a really interesting challenge between how, that's what we're trying to do with our next project, which are containers, is that how do we reduce that cost? And one way we're doing it, working with our client, Christian Almuda of Clifford Rears Housing, is really tackling parking. That still is in the mix.
Right.
So we're trying to find ways of providing the required parking, but have flexibility built into it so we can turn it into another program. And that's what we're looking at as well. Equally so, some of the projects we're doing, is there a possibility that the land could be leased to the clients, which I believe they're doing? And I know there was some comments about parking early in the early discussion. It's already in the mix, it's starting to work. That's so essential. That's an $800,000 to $1 million chunk that if they could address parking, and why would you need parking for homeless? So those are the issues that I believe are essential. So we also are working more as strategists. We're involved early with these projects. We're working with our clients, working with the city, and finding the right mix for these projects. And that's also a very important aspect of, of an architect to play more of a strategist as opposed to simply just designing it.
And who is your client, as in, are you working for a nonprofit foundation?
Yeah.
Or so is it one of the LA-based nonprofit foundations?
Yes, it is. Clifford Rears Housing, you're referring
right,
to?
Right, yeah. Right, right.
Christian, he was the director of housing at Skid Row Housing Trust.
Skid Row Housing Trust.
And
right,
now he's
right.
over there.
Right, because I will say that there was a reference earlier to LA kind of not having put much investment into the public housing sector or looked after its homeless, but I think actually the last 20 years or so has seen some fantastic work by LA architects for the nonprofit housing developers. It seems
right.
that's where there actually has been quite a deal of
right.
quite a level of creativity. Formally, to the extent the budgets allow, but also in terms of basic planning. I mean, we've done a number of interviews with folks at some of the nonprofit developers, and something that I've been told is that when it comes to say thinking about shared communal space, you know, external staircases or shared courtyard areas, that the nonprofit developers will put more investment in that because it is understood that that is therapeutic
uh-huh.
and helps with the reintegration into society, I
right,
guess, and
right.
getting more comfortable with socializing. And that's something that you wouldn't necessarily find in a private market rate development because
exactly.
it's like space
right.
wasted.
Right.
In
these projects, you're right. It's very important to have those aspects, so the gathering space.
Right,
to
right. But just in terms of, on the one hand, keep hearing now how these housing units coming from the nonprofit sector are really quite costly. There's $500,000 per unit. And yet, some of them are leading away in creating humane
uh-huh.
living environments.
Exactly.
Is that
That's a crucial issue of the design. I believe it makes the design better. You have opportunities to create strategic voids. Those become gathering spaces. And our Martin Luther King project, that's what happens. The tenants are encouraged to use the community kitchen. They're encouraged to use the community room because that's some way that they begin to engage socially. And that's an aspect to it. So it's a more of a hybrid where you have the privacy of your bedroom, focus on that, perhaps reduce the size of the kitchens and living rooms, but encourage them to be able to gather outside and communicate. And certainly in this climate, that's doable. And those are aspects that, as an architect, you take those elements and you make architecture out of that. So you try to solve those problems. And you can do it creatively, and you can do it inventively, and that's what we try to do.
And then lastly, before jumping to Deborah, light. One of the homeless experts we spoke with once on a previous program, she talked about finding that so many environments for the formerly homeless were so dismal, they were sort of punitive just in their space. There was this, she felt this attitude of you don't deserve anything better than a dark hole with a bed in it, and how important just that sense of light is. And certainly in your for-profit projects, you try and get two sources of a light
mm-hmm.
where possible into a unit. Is that something that people should also think
yes,
about?
Yes, I believe so. In this climate, certainly Los Angeles, it's very important to think of these buildings from the ecological standpoint in terms of people and the sustainable components. You really need to look at buildings to breathe. And there are these issues with the double loaded corridor in this aspect where you don't have flow of air. And I believe these
And light.
And it's equally important for these type of projects to have it. So that's what I was saying about our work doesn't deviate based on whether it's low income housing or whether it's market rate. We believe that you can do both. And that's beneficial because when people see these projects that have these aspects to it, which are design aspects, I remember going through the neighborhood meetings for this project in Martin Luther King. We got full support. It was, well, your building's better than mine. So, and that's a really important aspect. Now, and it's not just me. There's a number of my colleagues doing these projects. And that's something that's beneficial to the client, because it can delay 2 to 3 years if you don't get public support for it. But if you have that support, it benefits everybody. So I do believe design is important to this process, and be creative. And it's interesting how that is what's been happening within the city, that there are engaging architects who are committed and passionate about design to do these projects, because we have the resourcefulness in terms of designing projects that are efficient, that are on budget, because needless to say, a number of these projects are also prevailing wage, which adds additional cost to it. So there are multiple issues. On
and
that note,
cost of materials.
Exactly. Yeah. And the other interesting thing is this process, when you have tax credits and all these other variables, there are demands from if someone's providing you money and resources to do the project, they will tell you, we want a mix of materials. We want the doors to be green. You have to work around those parameters. And it can be challenging, but when you're getting funding, you need to take all that in the mix, and you have to be able to solve it. And that's what I believe the architect, that's the critical part of the architect, to make and build ideas isn't that easy, because you have enormous amount of forces.
Why?
One other project we're doing is we're trying to push away from the idea of tax credits, and project we're working right now is a hybrid between a hotel, affordable housing, and homeless housing. And we're trying to make the affordable housing for the client, who is it's a combination of for-profit developer and nonprofit, and see if they can work together to solve that problem, where you can actually create a solution similar to what you do, where it's a for-profit, to be able to see that people who are providing funding from a developer, not the city, or not in terms of tax credits, but to be able to make it work. And that should make it more efficient as well in certain ways. That has to be an ideal and a perfect scenario. So I think there are ways to get around this and continue to look for multiple ways to accomplish this, because each site's different, each context is different. And that's extremely important to look at all the aspects. And that's what I'm saying, we're in there in the early stages with these, looking at a mix, who should be involved, what's the program, how does that pencil out, and those are aspects that you deal with and you deal with. And architects, we're not always in that conversation. We tend to be the person they go to after they figured all that. But for us to be part of it, as part of a think tank of those issues, is really important. And it solves problems early on. And that's extremely critical to this process.
And
so it's about
that,
design, but it's about bigger ideas. It's about strategy.
Right, but it's also about taking the limitations, of which there are many, and mm-hmm. figuring out how to turn them to advantages to the extent you can. And in fact, Eric, where's Eric? Eric. I have a question, actually. In terms of the brief that the students have been given, are they being given latitude in terms of messing with the limitations that are in place, or are they being told to work with the rules? Right, but what I mean is, can they go and plonk a tower in the middle of a single family neighborhood or something like that? Okay, so you're giving them a lot of flexibility.
They will do things that we can't expect.
Okay.
That's part of why we're doing this, but I don't want them to hear that too much now.
So over to Deborah, who I think I first encountered when she was building the most beautiful retaining wall on Santa Monica Boulevard, always finds a way to take what could be a generic piece of infrastructure and turn it into something much, much better. And currently, as we've heard, one of her many projects that she's overseeing is the bridge housing temporary facility, the bridge home, which has been, boy, has some of those caused some controversy in neighborhoods. Recall efforts, people screaming, protests. You have to take all of that on board, and you look to design to be one of the tools to help smooth the process. Tell us about your work in that area.
So I hope that some of the students take on this issue, because I'm working on a different aspect of homelessness, and it has to do with how do we, as quickly as possible, get people off the streets into facilities where they can sleep indoors, get services from providers, and move to permanent supportive housing. So about 10, 12 months ago, the mayor said, I want to build 1,500 beds, for the homeless, one in each council district, and I want it done in a year. And they wanted construction drawings done in 30 days. They wanted the facility built in 3 months. We actually had to allocate 6 weeks for an environmental review. We did categorical exemptions. I'm sure the students aren't familiar with this, but those of you in practice will know. We need environmental clearance. The first categorical exemption, which usually is a page, was 500 pages because we had to do all the traffic noise, all the studies because of the controversies that we're facing. The first one out of the box was, of course, our council president who said, here's a site. I want to go first. I'm the council president. And the community, Koreatown, was up in arms. So after many months of discussion, that site was thrown out, and the project has now moved to a tennis court, which is an interesting when you think about that. So there was an empty lot. We looked around the city for city property. So we're looking right now. We have about, we have 13 active projects across the city. We have about 1,100 beds in some phase of production. We're doing three different types. And we're working with consulting architects as well as in-house architects. I have an architectural division under me of about 80 people. And our clients are many. Our clients are the mayor's office, who are actively, the mayor himself attends meetings on this. Our clients are the CAO, who manages the money, the chief administrative officer of the city. Our client is the LA Housing Authority. Our client are the providers. Our clients are the council districts. Our clients are the communities. So one of the most interesting community meetings we went to, and of course design plays a role. I love this, you said strategic voids. The first layout I saw for one of these facilities had parking for 6 cars, but no exterior space for people to gather. And it's one thing to provide beds, it's another to give a place for people to hang out so they don't immediately have to go back to the street if once the night is done. So I say, get rid of the cars. Make that a strategic void, a place to hang out. But the minute the providers got a look at that, they said, sorry, we can't park on the street. And then the community said, they can't park on the street because we need those parking spaces. So we had to put a few parking spaces back. Design is clearly important, but what's most important to everyone is get it done, and get it done as quickly as possible. So the challenges are many. Building department has 5 days to approve our plans. We've created a dashboard. So if you're late, you know, anyone in the city can log into that dashboard and see you, building department, are late. You know, your little task goes red, and no one wants their task to be red. And you know, we start by doing feasibility studies. Is there enough power at hand for that site? Is the utility there? We don't have to deal with zoning. There's an emergency action, so we don't have to. And these are supposed to be facilities for 3 years. Mm-hmm. So I said three types. We're working with sprung tents. Daylighting was important, so we have skylights on the sprung tents and a couple of windows. We're working with portables, the types that were used all over LAUSD campuses. And we're working with modular. And the sprung tents is a certain kind of space. We'll see how well they're liked. It's kind of big and maybe somewhat impersonal. The portables give the individual tenants a little more sense of enclosure. The modulars turn out to be more expensive. And the modular companies won't start production until they're given the contract. So that's a little difficult. It's not as if they have them sitting in their warehouse. You know, they have to have the contract. So we can't really effectively use them. If we have 3 months to build it, it's cheaper to stick build it or to buy portables or the sprung tents. So when it comes to design, it has to do with outdoor strategic voids, places for people to gather. It has to do with uses of color. It has to do with trying to give some presence to the street edge that, you know, the community won't totally hate and gives you a sense of you're coming to your place. And the whole goal of this is that, so we build 1,500 beds. That seems like a drop in the bucket. How many people are on the streets right now? 50,000? I don't know what the current count
53,000
is.
53,000 or 52,000.
But the idea is that people will cycle through this bridge housing, get the services and counseling that they need, and move to supportive housing. So the HHH money is building the supportive housing. Mm-hmm. The H money, the countywide money, is funding the operations of these facilities. So one of the challenges we face is we finish a design, and you finish CDs in 30 days for one of these facilities. The operator hasn't been chosen because we were just told go. Now we've brought an operator in, and they start looking at our design, and they say, oh, we need 5 more offices, and we need lockers. When people come in, we need something called an amnesty locker. So if they come in with a knife, they need to be able to put it in a locker as soon as they walk in the door, and it has to be covered and secure. We're going to have, this is 100, typically these are 100 beds, and they're split male, female. We need bathrooms. We need 5 bathrooms for staff, because we're going to have 20-plus staff on site. Think about that, 20-plus staff on site for 100 people. That's great, but we had tried to standardize certain components, like the admin trailer and the bathroom trailers, and the admin trailer was totally inadequate for that kind of staffing. So we're learning. You know, I think the governor I heard yesterday said $500 million going to homelessness. I think by the time we get maybe mid-year this year, we'll really understand what we're doing better and be able to say, here's the best approach. Really create standardized strategies to it. Because we didn't have the benefit of talking to operators, talking to all the other clients before we were told to go. In addition, some of these other facilities are HHH-funded. They're permanent facilities. They're called navigation centers. So we're also working on places where homeless can come, store their belongings, take a shower, get some advice from a counselor, and then they may sleep somewhere else. And we're adapting some city buildings for that purpose as well.
We definitely heard about it when the Koreatown one was initially floated, and we were getting emails and calls at the station from people complaining and wanting to, you know, that, I think it was Thomas Newman mentioned that when people were asked, something like 69% of people in a neighborhood actually would welcome a bridge home or permanent supportive housing in their neighborhood, but the loud 27% were the ones that got heard, and we certainly were hearing from the loud 27% at the start of that process, and we were hearing from people who were complaining. On the one hand, we don't want this bridge home because it's not really going to be a bridge, it's going to be here forever. And then on the other hand, we were hearing, and we don't like it because it looks like a tent, and it should look like something more permanent. So I'll get on to some of the other things we heard later, but what did you decide about the kind of the tent look? You know, was the tent, did the tent work for it or not work for it? The sprung tent.
Yeah, so you saw one of the sprung tents that's being built up here. I don't really have a final opinion about what I think about it. What I did hear from one of my staff members is that they visited a facility that had been retrofitted for bridge housing when we started the process, and Every person gets a bed and kind of a storage cubby, and then they have a 5-foot high kind of partition between them and the next person. And when they visited one that had been previously built, the residents had put sheets over the top, they had put curtains in, they had made an enclosed sleeping space, which means that all the sprinklers we put in for fire safety were now rendered kind of useless. But the fire department in these situations said it needs to be open. So it's kind of a cavernous space, and I don't know how it's going to feel. We're doing the first one right now. It may be since modular building right now, until we have a chance to breathe and can maybe pre-order or standardize and pre-order, that portables is really a better way to go. The first, we did finish one facility at El Pueblo, and Gensler and Associates came in and did the outside patio, and I think it's functioning pretty well. And it was a very awkward site. It's between two freeway, it's an on-ramp and a freeway and a major road. It's a triangular site, so we sort of surrounded an interior courtyard, and Gensler came in and did the courtyard. I think it's functioning pretty well.
That, now, that's an issue that that location that you just mentioned close to the freeway, and Lorcan, you showed a project that's close to the freeway, that gets to a general issue that we have in LA right now, which is housing being built by the freeways. And the air quality is not good. And are these projects being designed in such a way as to be turned away from the freeway? Is there air filtration? You know, are you having to take a ameliorate, I guess, the...
Yes, our project in Isla, which you'll see here, it's right next to the 110 and 105, which is a very difficult place. These are part of the more the challenging sites that the city has available. I believe it's one of the 1,700 properties that they're putting out. So our client landed it, they got the project, and so our challenge was multiple. It's actually three or four sites. One is a public works piece of land, another one was owned by the city. Coincidentally, it turns out one of the other properties is privately owned. You can imagine having to try to navigate that and to create, resolve all those issues of these three or four properties have to become one, in a way, a continued site. Equally so, it's right next to, obviously, the freeway. So there is an alley that wasn't used very much. So we were part of the process of working with the city to have them vacate it as a paseo. And that would be the green lung. That would be the strategy we're using is between the freeway and our building, there is a small alley that we're using. There it is right there. So we're actually now working with the city, and we're working with funding to provide the resources to build trees and to think about the right type of tree, how we can create some kind of landscape buffer so that obviously the toxins from the freeways do not affect the people. And that's a really critical issue because we all see these horrendously awful buildings next to freeways downtown. But there's a way from a design standpoint to don't do that, do the opposite. And that's critical. And I think that, to me, for students to think about is that's what's being a designer. It's about looking, going further, trying to rethink those kind of conventions and see if there's an opportunity to create a green veil, so to speak, that will purify to the best of your ability. And then those sites become more readily available. And that was what I was referring to, the idea of being part of the think tank, because we were there early on working with this. And so we worked with the city, worked with the client to find ways to mitigate this. And on that one, coincidentally, city council person wants a container building. So it's, I think it's primarily an aesthetic issue. Yes. But we're trying to work that through. So we're working with one of our vendors in Detroit. We're building a container project there. And coincidentally, it's called Giant Containers, and they're very resourceful. They've opened an office in LA. So it's really about having to take all those elements together and then putting it together as an architect. And that's what I'm referring to about it's exciting for me because you play multiple roles, you wear many hats. It's exciting. But that was critical to that one. We're creating, in a way, a green lawn to be able to cleanse the air before it gets to the building.
As I stated earlier, I hope some of you think about this bridge housing because we're going to be building more. And it would be interesting to see design solutions and maybe it's portables. I mean, how do we make a temporary facility for homeless aesthetically pleasing, welcoming, so that people do come in and offers opportunities for them to begin the process of transitioning off the streets.
Great. Okay. Absorb everything that you've just heard. And now, though, we're going to take a little pivot. That's a popular term these days. We're going to pivot to Mexico City, and we're going to invite Carlos Cedillo to come up on stage. He was part of the transition team for the new national housing policy in Mexico, and he served as deputy director for sustainability for Infonavit. Did I pronounce that correctly?
Perfect.
Which was a really interesting program. It wound up involving some talent from SCI-Arc, which you'll tell us about. But I'll just say that he's had a fabulous education, been at Yale, he teaches at many architecture schools, and he's currently running a foundation called Pienza Sostenible, which helps to design and build homes for the very poor in Mexico. That builds on your work with Infonavit. But right now, we're just going to take a little breath, and we're going to hear about Infonavit, and then we will bring you back into the group, Carlos.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for having me here. I think I want to start with a reflection. I think I've been in a low-income Charrette for the past 8 years, and it's really moving to come after spending pretty much every weekend for the past 8 years and coming to such a fantastic school, and you know, only 1 week after school starts, all students being here trying to figure out how to make life better for people out there that don't have a house. I think it's fantastic, Hernan, and it's fantastic for all of you guys to be doing this. And I, you know, I was trying to think when I was a student at Yale, and I was really worried second year because I was looking that most of my classmates already got offers from like all the famous architects. And they were probably better architects than myself. But very fast I realized that there weren't enough Guggenheim museums or airports or big houses to be done. So at that time I started doing research and I realized that that housing was a major issue. That only on my country, pretty much half of the population didn't have a house. So I realized really fast that there was a big opportunity for architects to be involved with housing. And the thing that I, and when I say I, it means a lot of people, apologize for my English, a lot of people have been working with me in this, including some of the professors here, and I want to thank you guys for joining those crazy moments when I called you to design a little house and then a little building for the low income. You did a terrific job, and I think that's why I'm here today, and thank you so much to Hernan for inviting me to be part of these new days at SCI-Arc. But my first advice, and treat them like clients. I mean, I was hearing, you know, people were talking about like the 21,000 people out there was a problem for the city, and I don't think it's a problem. I think it's a possibility for architecture to happen. So there's like, I don't know if it's 21,000 or 50,000 homeless. What's the exact number here? 52,000 clients out there ready for you to go and design their houses. And that's wonderful. So you're sitting in a profession with enormous possibilities. And these are some of the families that we designed and built houses for in the foundation I created with my brother after the earthquakes. And I just wanna show you because there's people, you know, some of them hoarding their plans and their models and standing in front of their houses designed by fantastic architects. But the thing that we must not do to these people is to treat them unfairly. And history has shown us that low-income housing and that bad housing affects mostly the poor. And that generally, when there's a bad house, there's a big probability that there's no architect related to that type of housing. I mean, a lot of those houses that you see, I can assure you that in the one down to the left, done by a big developer called Casasgeo, no architect was involved. So there's a big opportunity. Imagine in the institution that I used to work for till November 30th, we financed 1,500 homes every day. Every single day, 1,500 homes into Mexican cities. Is that a problem or a possibility for change? And I think it's a possibility for change because there's money, and someone was mentioning that money was ready. That's a lot of money. Someone mentioned like 1.2 billion. I don't even know what that is. Sounds a lot. But if you use it wisely, you don't need more. You just need more thought. And thinking, which is the thing that you're gonna be doing for the next couple of days, is the cheapest mechanism we have as designers. So thinking, it's really crucial. So I hope in the next couple of days you really think about those things. You have to do a lot of research of the things that have been done in the past everywhere that cannot happen in your projects. And one really important thing, if you think that you're gonna solve the problem by running to your computers and creating a terrific image without walking around tonight or tomorrow morning and figuring out how these people live, because some of you probably walked 1,000 times without even questioning, why are these people out there? What do they need? How do they live? Where they lived before, they were on the streets. you won't be able to solve the problem. So treat them as clients, you know, ask them questions. I don't know whether that'd be possible this weekend, but try. Engage with the community. It's impossible to design without being in the community that you're designing for. And you worry about the 52,000 that you have here, but I come from a country, from a beautiful country, just a couple hours away from here, which is nice. Maybe we can go and check it out. It's beautiful. But where 50% of the population lives in poverty, and a lot of them live in extreme poverty. I don't know if people know what extreme poverty means in terms of income. Well, someone that is in extreme poverty lives every day with less than $1.9 per day, and that's very little. So sometimes we go out to communities and try to help people that actually live with families of four or six under $2 per day. And we have 9.4 million people living in those conditions. And so we started going out to communities with Piensa, and I'm gonna show some of the work. And sorry, it's hard, because yesterday there's some of my students, because now I'm gonna be teaching a seminar here. I did a presentation yesterday of 500 slides, but they asked me to do it today in 10, so it's gonna be really difficult. Because we have done over 1,000 projects relating to housing and other things. So I think understanding what poverty is crucial, because in Mexico it's a combination. It's not only tackling housing. You have to think about social security. You have to think about health services. Social security is such a crucial thing in housing if you want to finance a house, because I don't think giving away free housing is the answer. Often, we make that mistake. If you don't generate involvement with the people, I don't think anyone likes anything for free, or you don't treat it the same way. You know, when someone comes and gives you something for free, it's really different than when you work for it. So we have to think, you know, whether some of these people have some kinds of disabilities that could be an opportunity also for architecture to happen. We need to get them involved. So that's a crucial part of the exercise. So do not take away that from your exercises. And another thing that you need to do in depth is analyzing territory. I think it's and this is just a drawing for a project that we've been doing in a town in the Caribbean, and we're trying to analyze land and other things. But instead of running, you know, I'm trying to deliver the first image of that house for that person out there. I'd say first, like, find out who's that person, and then understand territory. You have to walk every block, look at the best spot to do the project. I'm going to show you some images of the projects we did and tell you a little bit. So remember those houses I showed you in the beginning? They practically built the exact same house a million times. And that's, I'm not lying, a million times, the exact same prototype that didn't work. They thought, oh, it's a great idea, it's really cheap, let's give it to the families, all the same. So we team up with a wonderful group of architects, which include Pancho's, you know, Pancho Pardo? I was gonna call Pancho some, I call him differently, we're good friends. Pancho and Alberto Calach and a lot of architects helped us develop whether it was possible to reuse some of those existing housing units and give it a little bit different character. And then the project below was a really interesting project done by Alberto Calach. And it was super interesting, and if there's developers in the room, they're gonna be really excited, because this is the only project that within a year increased its value on 25%. Those houses developed by Alberto Calach down there were 72 meters and around $15,000. $15,000 in Hermosillo, and after 1 year, the houses were much more, 25% more. So I'm just gonna be showing you some images, hold on, of those projects. This is, sorry I don't show the previous image, but One thing that housing requires is land. And what you're seeing in this image is there used to be the electric towers. You know, those where people hang cables. Like 10 years ago, you weren't able to build around those things. But there's new technology. So what we did in the city of Aguascalientes, by doing research, we figured out that there were a lot of electric lines cutting the city. And when they were taken out, we realized that a plot of land of 400 meters by 8 kilometers was free in the middle of the city. So there are ways in which you can look at land. And some of the people that were speaking before me found places and residual spaces for housing to happen. Public space is a crucial part. You cannot see housing as a separate thing. The other exercise, you know, remember those little houses, and also some SCI-Arc faculty work with us in this exercise. Basically, we were replacing those bad homes by doing small buildings, and it was really exciting project. The nice thing about that exercise, and let me just go to this really fast. When I got to Infonavit, at an institution that was producing 1,500 homes, the first thing I realized is there weren't any architects involved, which was ridiculous. I mean, with the amount of construction, and rapidly we start like calling every architect we knew. I had the opportunity to meet Hernan when I was back at Yale, and I called him. It's like, hey, we need help, and we need like serious help. We need to think outside of the box. And to date, we had worked with around 700 offices from all over the world, trying to figure out what to do in terms of housing, and that's Hernan's prototype, which I really liked. We didn't build it, but we did build others. And they're there, and it was fantastic, you know, to give to some of your professors, and it's really tough. And we don't have enough time, but hopefully you can sit with some of them and ask them how difficult it is to design a house that is $10,000 in rural Mexico. So it's going to be really hard to design a house for someone who doesn't have a house in downtown LA. So it's not a simple task what you're facing in the next couple of days. So, and this was pretty crazy, no? The board of directors at the institution allowed us to build them together, to build them full scale, because they're 10,000 US, no? Some of you guys make models that are more expensive than 10,000, I bet. So maybe we should think about that too. Anyway, it's a really big model, but I call it it's like a Bisonhof of rural housing in Apan Hidalgo. And we got most architects, Hilary Sample and Michael Meredith did the master plan. They picked the houses that were going to be built. It wasn't me, so because I didn't feel I had nor the knowledge nor the capacity, and I didn't want to get involved on saying which ones we were going to build. But now they're done, and it's quite a beautiful place because what we try to do is like to realize that and. Someone was saying that replication is good in low-income housing. I don't think it's good. I think it takes away two things, you know, the possibility of architects to be involved to start. If you produce the same thing, what is the... and secondly, families are different, territories are different. So I think architecture by ration. So my suggestion is instead of taming it, go as crazy as you can. Because the solution is really hard. And now I'm going to show really fast some of the work I do during the weekends. And this started after a horrible earthquake in September 7th and then September 19th. We're really concerned. Around 250,000 homes got destroyed after the earthquake. And there was a coincidence that those houses were also the houses of the very poor. When I say the very poor, it's like people living in extreme poverty. So a group of well-known architects, which include Alberto Kalach, Tatiana Bilbao, Mauricio Rocha, many others, we teamed up and start going to communities and asking families what they needed. At first, we didn't have a dime. We have no idea how we're going to build, but at least we start engaging those. Luckily enough, really fast, we team up with a lot of people, which include really weird connections. This guy that uses Instagram, which has like 100 million followers, and I'm not kidding, 100 million followers, called us, said like, hey, I want to help. It's like, yeah, why don't you just send out a message? Within 10 days, he raised over $2 million. And then he called us, and then we went out to communities. But this time, we brought the architects. And it was such a beautiful experience because we will come and say, like, hey, let me introduce you to Alberto Kalach. He's going to be your architect. And it's like, Alberto, what? I mean, for architects in Mexico, it's really fantastic if someone like Alberto Kalach come and knocks at your door and tells you that he's... And he comes and knocks at your door after taking a 25-hour bus drive, talking to other architects to go to the poorest community in Mexico. And I'm going to show you some of the images of the houses that we produce, never bringing something from outside, learning from vernacular procedures. There's one that's Pancho's house in Oquilan. We started teaching people how to do the furniture, the doors, producing all pieces of the house, building the houses with them. Involvement is crucial. If there's something they can do, you should get them involved. This is a house I designed and built with my friends, and I did with the family, always being really careful. I mean, one thing that is absurd in low-income housing, the first thing they come, they tear all trees. No, it's like they come and clean up. Which is ridiculous. I mean, if a family has a tree like that, that's the first thing you should acknowledge, and that's crucial also for the process. We start using things like bamboo, another means of material. This is a project by Alberto Kalach in San Mateo del Mar also, and some other images. I'm going to show you a video that will address a little bit better the work we do in communities, and it has some pump-up music. But it has a pumped music because it was December 2017 after the earthquake. We didn't have a single cent to build a house. And then a really famous DJ from, I think, Czech Republic called us. His name is Solomon, really big. I mean, this is like a Ibiza megastar. And he called us and he said, hey, I want to give $20,000. He said, what can I do with that? We told him, two houses. He said, what? Two houses? And it was true. We were able to build two houses with the amount of money that Solomon gave us. And I'm going to show you that video. Feel free to dance. I think what you're going to be doing the next days, although it's a sad topic, is really a happy theme for you guys to be involved. So let me see if I can push play. I guess it's this. That's in the middle of, that's really far. That's Rosana Montiel's, Alberto Kalach. We're doing 200 houses by 200 different architects right now. That's us showing the models to the families. If they don't like it, we do it again. That's Felipe Uribe, Colombian architect. We always show them real plans. We don't hide anything, models. Show them how construction is done. We show them how to build. The idea is that when we leave those communities, they'll be able to do it on their own. Thank you. And often you get to those communities. I mean, there we were sleeping in tents. At least here you can, you know, go to your houses and think about the charrette. But so I think you have everything to solve the problem. You know, there are bigger issues, harder issues, I would say. I won't say bigger, but I think it can be done. We started doing like hybrids with vernacular building. That's Tatiana Bilbao, also in the community. Anyway, we're showing this because I think we're gonna do a summer camp in one of the communities helping. All these houses are under 10,000 US. Well, some, to say the truth. I mean, some we spend a little bit more, it depends. That's Mauricio Rocha. Anyway, you can clap. It's really tough to do that. But what's really beautiful about the project is that an architect got paid, whether you believe it or not. And we paid them 7%. But we paid them 7% because we believed, you know, maybe 7% of those 10,000 wasn't enough, but we wanted to show everyone that our profession mattered. And out of respect, we were paying the same amount that any other, actually 7%, if a big project pays you 7%, as architects, we'll be happy. So something really beautiful happened. We start getting calls from all over the world. Right now, I'm, you know, people like Rafael Aranda from RCR, a Pritzker winner, is doing a house. David Ajay is doing a house. And we start getting calls from all over the place that they just wanted to help. And the amazing thing is that all the architects that come and do a house with us, I think it changes the way in which they see other projects. So I think just use this amazing opportunity this weekend. And Hernan told me not to, but I'm gonna use this opportunity to, because he invited me to give a seminar. I know you guys already picked your classes, but it's gonna be open to public every Thursday night. And we're gonna be talking about poverty and hunger and opportunity for architecture to happen every Thursday night. I think there's a lot to be done. And in the first class, every class there's gonna be guest lecturers. We're gonna have Manuel Cervantes. Manuel did three houses with us out in the community, so he's gonna speak about this. This is a house that does, he's like designing George Clooney's house right now, but also he's doing a house with us in, and also we'll have Gonzalo Lebrija, an artist, on Thursday too, because we're doing a reflection on Mexico's conquest 500 years ago and what happened to communities in Mexico. So yeah, that's it. I would say that it's an amazing opportunity to be thinking about housing. And I really believe that really fantastic things are going to come out of this school. So thank you so much for all the professors that decided to join those first exercises, and looking forward to spend time with you all and learning and walking and seeing you guys work for the next couple days and the semester. Thank you.
So I think that our time is up. I should just sort of back announce, as we say, and I didn't clarify right at the top that that what your work came out of was what you and many others saw as an ill-conceived effort to build housing by the government, enormous numbers of units. Mm-hmm. They looked to developers who produced cookie-cutter housing, like the one you show bottom mm-hmm. left, and then there was a big effort to try and improve the quality by reaching out to architects. Do I understand the whole project properly? Is that's what in front of it was about?
No, but in front of it is the third biggest mortgage lender in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And I was their head of research for 7 years.
Mm-hmm.
When I entered in front of it, there wasn't any architecture. So I started calling architects to join and try to make them team up with private developers. That's one part of the work.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other part of the work is because developers weren't doing any of these projects, we decided to go out on our own and started a non-for-profit that start helping communities and building those houses. So it's two separate things.
Got it. And that's how that all emerged. I had promised that we would have time for questions now, but I must check in with Eric. I think actually we're running out of time. Are we running out of time, or do we have... Yes. So I'm sorry to overpromise, but if anyone in the room has questions, will you three be available for them to to pitch sure. questions to? And likewise, Carlos, will you be around
yeah.
if there's questions from the audience? Okay. Well, with that, thank you so much for your keen attention. And we're all very excited to see what comes out of this weekend, Charrette. And I just want to thank you all, Carlos, Kevin, Lorcan, Deborah, thank you so much for sharing your expertise in building housing, and I hope it's been very helpful to you all.
So,
that's it
was an incredible amount of people coming here today, spending time and sharing their knowledge with us. I think it's very rare for architects to do something that matters and to be called to that table to make a contribution to such an important, and as Carlos actually made us feel like such a cool also project for us to tackle. So my hope is that all the students will come to that table today knowing that their contribution, their voice, their creativity, their ideas are going to be heard by the most incredible people in the city. Thank you.
I really enjoyed today. I think that you can't go at this problem without, from a kind of naive point. And so I think it was so good to hear from everybody the kind of nature of the problem. And I would just suggest that you know, it would be really important to continue to flesh out what we even mean by what the problem is and the nature of the problem. And make that as broad as possible. And I would imagine it would involve ideas about what do we mean by democracy today? What do we mean by institutionalizing things? What is the purpose of even of things like city councils and building and safety and all these other things we heard about today, and how we can think about how all of those things come together in this issue. That's the one thing. The other thing I would say is I know that some people in the room here are interested in aesthetics, and I would just say take this head on. There's going to be a lot of architects are let's say nervous to talk about aesthetics in relation to certain subjects in architecture that seem to be loaded culturally and socially, and I would just say take that on and think about what kinds of aesthetics are relevant here, how you can bend your project into a project which may appear to be all about organization, function, and logistics. And I think that's really important, especially here at SCI-Arc. So thanks. Good luck.
Just going to repeat something I told the postgraduate students that I'm going to be working with this weekend, as one of them, as a student myself. I think it's a really beautiful thing to see an entire school giving over a weekend. So I think it's a nice thing, because this is a project outside of our normal activities, that we approach it in a spirit of charity, and it is a kind of giving. We can't go and give somebody a home, but we can give them our intelligence and our time and our labor this weekend. And I think there are two things that are kind of unique assets that we may bring to the table. We're not experts, but maybe that's one of the two things that are kind of unique that we're bringing to this. One is our very naivete, that we're not experts, I think, might give us a chance at having a fresh perspective on problems that are clearly being worked on extremely hard. And maybe there might be a diamond in the rough this weekend that might be kind of interesting and something maybe that hasn't been thought of, precisely because it might be so crazy. The second thing is we're an extremely international school. I believe we're 60% international. And I think that's also maybe something that's unique. So those of you that are from other places and other countries, you might be thinking to yourselves, well, what right do I have to have an opinion about this? But I think it's precisely your perspective from somewhere else that might be an extremely valuable thing that we haven't seen yet. So with that, I look forward to seeing what all of you come up with.